Hello, in this video tutorial I'm going to show how to create a game object from script and how to create something like a loading screen effect by manipulating the vertices, the UVs and triangles of that specific game object. The interesting part here is that I do not have a script for each monitor. Here I am going to use a coroutine which makes the update procedure efficient and doesn't influence the frame rate in a significant way. Okay, here you see how it's going to look in the end. At the beginning, I'd like to show you how this huge texture looks like where all pictures are within. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 advertisement pictures we'd like to change on the screen regularly. And we are doing it by manipulating the information of the specific game object. Okay, let's have a closer look at the code. At the beginning, we have those variables. At first, I'm going to get a specific shader. I could have used the standard shader, but I wanted to have this shader in this example because it appears more like a glowing screen having this one, and not every shader can be seen the polygon from both sides, so some specific shaders create a picture only viewing the polygon from one specific direction. So you have to be careful here. And in the next step, I define where the specific motifs within my huge texture are. Here I have my texture and I choose for each of those sections two specific points. And the interesting part here is I have a vector with four dimensions. This makes life easy later on. In this example, at last, this was the best idea I could came up, because here the very first two entries are the X and Y position of the bottom left corner of this section. And the third and fourth position are the X and Y positions of the second point defining this specific sections. And going on, here we have the other sections of the other preview pictures. I decided to create in the very first frame 1, 2, 3, 4 different game objects, and those here are the sizes of the computer screens. We have smaller and bigger ones with different ratios. Here I am creating all computer screens with the basic function here, and at the very first time, in the very first frame, those game objects have to be created. And this part is empty, but it still has, there has to be something to stand in this function. If this wasn't the case here, I still would have to write null, but I want to fill my already existing array. So now I'm creating those four game objects and I have them in this array. And I'm placing them apart with 5 units from each. And also in the very first frame I'm starting the important coroutine. Like you can see here, I do not have anything in the update function. I'm going to explain now why. At first, let's go to the coroutine. It starts at the very first frame and it goes on the whole time in a loop. I choose this concept in order to keep the frame rate high, and depending on my values, I'm going to set here at this place and at this one, or let's say here, I can choose that the game goes on like it's used to go, and I am able to say the screens, or at least one screen, should be updated every frame, or it should be updated every few milliseconds, or maybe every 5 seconds or every 10 seconds. And if I have a screen being updated once in a minute or every few seconds, I do not have this whole calculating procedure within each frame. And if you choose your values wisely, the user will not notice a drop in frame rate, because you do not have to update it regularly. However, let's start. Here are some values at the beginning. At the beginning of one of those procedures here, I am taking one of my already existing game objects, one of my already existing computer screens, by random. Let's say I have a room with 100 computers in my game, and it isn't nice to have a few hundred scripts updating those screens regularly. So I have here my one script, and it always chooses one of those specific computer screens, and this one specific computer screen will be the important object in the next few seconds. So I got my index number of this one. Here I get the very next screen number, index of the screen I'd like to display on this specific game object. Here I choosing how long this update procedure should take. It's a period, and the length of the period, considering the time here. And here I'm deciding how flawless the update procedure should be. I could say I want to make it look like having a bad frame rate, or I could make it very smooth by raising this value here. Here I decided to have 1200 update steps, so that it looks nearly flawless in my eyes. Yeah, I'm setting my starting values here. I'm calculating them, and here, for depending on how many steps I wanted to have for each step, I'm going once a update procedure through. Here with this function, this is an important function I'm going to explain later on. Here I am putting in my game object, my new computer screen. I am telling the function which part, which motive should be, which of those one should be the new one, and which one is the already existing one, and which is the new one. And here I am telling this function in which position of the update I am. This value goes between 0 and 1. So with a 0 value, the update procedure is starting right at this moment. And having here a 1, the update procedure is at its very end. Here I am telling as a function how big our new computer screen should be. Regularly it is always the very same size, but because I am able to use this function at the very beginning for creating those game objects, I have to tell this function how big the size of this specific computer screen is. And here I am giving the main texture in, because it could be that I have maybe 5 huge textures where I'd like to pick some images from. And in this example, I have only one collection of pictures, which is in this texture file here. And here is the array which describes where the specific images are of this big texture. Here I'm giving in the shader. And now our update is done, and I'm going to add a new value to my position of the update procedure. And having done all this, the script is sleeping for a few seconds here. That means the regular program is going on, and once this time is over, this part will be continuing at this very moment here. In this example, here I have only a few milliseconds. The player doesn't notice loss of frame rate, because this part is only calculating, let's say, once every 2 seconds, depending on this value here. Now the whole procedure is done once, and we are writing the current motive in our array for the future, that we do not have sudden changes within the motive. And now we are waiting 3 seconds until this procedure starts once again. And maybe from the very same computer screen, or maybe of one of the many other computer screens which are in the very same scene. Okay, and now let's view this important function, assuming this is the most important part of this tutorial here. Okay, here we are. At the beginning, I'm defining my mesh, which I'm going to manipulate the values. And if I do not have any game object, if I do not have any computer screen given, this script, this part here of the script, creates this very game object. In the very first frame, we do have nothing. This part is null. And now we are creating the game object. It's an empty game object. We are adding here a mesh renderer. The important part is we have to have here add component and not get component. However, we also have to see what the mesh filter is. We are adding here the mesh filter, and it is this one we also rating here. Also, we give this very game object the main texture, which we got from here, and we give it a specific shader, which we also got. You could also put this part, let's say, as an example here. Then you would be able to change the texture, the main texture, every time using this function. Let's say you are having one small picture of the big texture file number one, and a few seconds later you want to have another picture of another texture file. So you are able to change the huge texture files every few frames or every few seconds, minutes, however you'd like to. But in this example we have only one. Okay, now we go on. Here is an interesting part happening. We are now manipulating the vertices, the UVs and the triangles. At first, here I am defining how many columns of this update procedure I'd like. I choose 10. How long it will take for one simple column to go through the update procedure. The relative position within this column. If we are looking at the vertical component within one of those columns, here I used a modulo value and then I divided it by the very same value here. Okay, I have here my value where I am within the time procedure. And this value is between 0 and 1. But I want to know specific where I am concerning this very column I am looking at right now. So I choose the part of where I am at the moment and divide it once more during the time it would need to build a whole column. And so I got a whole new value here, which is between 0 and 1, and it gives me the position from the height of my updating border concerning this very specific column. And because I want to start from above and go below, I have to set here 1 and subtract this very value which comes out here. Now, absolute height of our column, x relative position of current column. This could be interesting. Also, here I had a bug and I'm not sure how I solved it right now. However, to get rid of this bug, I put here a minus 0.5 to get the specific position, the specific integer value, where I am with my column building procedure at this moment. And because I want to have specific values like 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5, and so on. I, on one hand, have to use a round to integer value, but I need in the very end a more specific value. So I have to divide it by this very value here once more in order to get those final values of 0.1, 0.2. relative weight of one single column, x absolute position of current column. Here I get the value from which could be between 0 and 1 and get the screen size. Analog here the y value and the screen size the y value to have the absolute sizes. Okay, now let's start with calculating the vertices. I already know that I have 12 vertices. The vertices are the points in the three-dimensional room. Here I got this example. We have 12 points, but we have to be careful because counting starts by 0, and I am creating this single object has two separate parts which do, they have some points at the very same positions, but you should imagine it like having a small gap here between those different polygons. So let's say we have vertices, the vertex number 0, number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5. This is this part here. And then we have a new part starting with number 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. This is this part here. And now we are calculating the three-dimensional vector where those points, where those vertices should be. Here is nothing much to say. We have those positions. We have the height of the screen, which is the y value of the screen size here. And what's interesting is here the array entry at number 1. We have to get this value here and also have to consider the height of this column. This very wide here has to be considered, and the position y is the very same here. And yeah, so we have those points here. To make it more efficient for the computer, I decided to, whenever possible, reference back to already existing values. For example, here I have the position of the array entry with a number 6. It is a very same position like the array position with the entry number 1, because this number 6 is at the very same position with like this number 1 here. So those both points are at the very same position, and I do not have to make those whole calculations here once more. I'm just copy pasting it here. And also here number 9, 10, 11, 9, 10, 11 have also one already existing, already calculated value. This may look like not much at the moment, but considering one day you will have maybe a lot of such functions and it could get a few more frames per second if you are considering just taking already existing values. Okay, now here we are calculating the UVs. We have something similar here. We also have 12 UV positions in this area, and for each vertex we calculated before, we also have to define where a representant of those vertices should be on the two-dimensional texture. And like I already told before, I have the system, I came up with a system of defining each part with two separate points. Let's say at this part here, I need the texture which will be displayed in this part here. This could be, for example, the green texture here. And I also need the part which will be displayed at this very position here. This could be the blue texture here. And for each of both images, I have two points. For the old image, which would be in this example the green here, I have the old advertisement number and I have this four-dimensional vector. And this single four-dimensional vector contains the x and y position of this dot here, and it also contains the x and y position of this dot here. And analog, at this blue part here, I have my four values. I have the x and y position of this part, of this point, and I also have the x and y position of this very point here. And now I'm going to put for each of those points, for each of these vertices, a specific position in the UV texture. Let's say, I'm just showing it here. It took quite, I'd not say a lot of time, but I had to find some bugs here, because it got a little bit complicated later on. But yeah, I think it looks manageable. Also interesting is here, to make life easy, I have this four-dimensional vector, and we have usually the components of x, y, z, but because it's a four-dimensional vector, we also have the w component, which is the fourth component of this four-dimensional vector. And yeah, so it's important to have a really close look on these endings here. And to make life easy for the computer later on, I also try to use already existing calculated values from earlier wherever possible. Here are the first six values. The first part, this is the new part of the image, and this is here the old part of the image of the UV points. Now, in the next step, we are defining the triangles. Like you can see here, we have the very first triangle, which consists of the numbers 0, 1 and 2. Here we have 0, 1 and 2. And the important information here is that all three consecutive following numbers, or let's say it's this way, three consecutive index position numbers represent one polygon. Here I made always a new row, a line break, to make it more visually. And these three here represent this polygon. The numbers 0, 2, 3 represent the second one. The numbers 0, 3, 5 represent 0, 3, 5, this one. And 3, 4, 5 3, 4, 5 represents this part here. And we could go on with 6, 7, 11, 6, 7, 11, 11, 7, 8, 11, 8, 9, 11, 9, 10, and we have the whole picture. Now at the end, depending on what you want to do, you have to change only very specific parts, but I often had bugs at other examples, and it suddenly helped just to clear the mesh before editing specific values. I don't know why, but in the examples I had before, it helps a lot if you want to. Well, let me paraphrase this. If you do not know exactly what you are doing like an expert, I would always clear the mesh I'm working around at the moment within. Like, I'm also no expert, and maybe an expert would say here at this point, leave this out and make the other part more professional, and we are saving a few frames in the future. But this works well enough for me. However, I'm clearing the whole mesh, and then I'm entering the new values for the vertices of this mesh, the new values of the triangles of this mesh, and the new UV values of this mesh, which we have been calculating, which we calculated before. Now at the end, let's make an optimization. At some specific object, it would save in the long run a lot of time. At least I'm assuming it at the moment. If it's really necessary, I'm not sure at the moment. But for later other projects, I left this part here within this code. And now at the very end, we are giving this object out, which we wouldn't have to return if we would only update this object, but in the very first frame we want to get an object out of this function, because this is the part we are able to move around and give it a new position. And I think this was everything important. Yeah, let's have once more a final look. And so it's looking. It's waiting 3 seconds. Now it chooses randomly one of the already existing computer screens, and it's updating one already existing picture with the other picture within these 5 seconds. Now it's choosing another one randomly. This time this one, and it's updating a new picture, and we are once more waiting 3 seconds, and it's again starting to update a picture. I hope this tutorial was helpful, and thank you for watching.